Hey there, my name's Drew Brashler, and in this video, I want to talk to you about headamp, preamp, and gain on your Behringer X32 or your console, and how that affects our audio in our mix. Now, if you're brand new to my channel, I'm all about helping you feel more confident with your production gear no matter where you're starting from. So let's go ahead and dive in. Now, with preamp, gain, headamp, there's a lot of different names for it. It's very important because it takes our microphone level from our microphone and turns it up to a level that our mixer can actually mix. And then with that line level mix that it creates, that can then be outputted to a speaker or an amplifier to then be amplified through that speaker to be listened to by your audience. Now, if you don't have enough preamp gain on this microphone, on the channel, then your output is always going to be quiet. Or the other way is, if you have too much preamp gain, then you can actually get distortion and really gross sounding inputs. Now, the level that you set that gain to matters, and it actually changes on every console that you're on. There's a slightly different nominal gain level on every console. Now, why do we need to have this nominal gain level? Well, what happens with audio is when you have multiple channels that are all producing similar frequencies, all of those frequencies that are similar join together and make that frequency louder. And then if you have other frequencies that are also equivalent to each other, those frequencies are louder. And so for instance, if you're ever listening to a mix and it sounds boomy, or there's just a lot of like low-end mud, that's because all of the channels that are going into that console all create this sound in like the 200 hertz area, the 150 to 200 hertz area. Most instruments create that sound. And so if you don't mix it correctly, all of that can build up together and create this really loud sound. Now, where this becomes a problem is when you have a console that has 32 channels, for instance. The X32 has our 32 main channels here. And if we have all 32 channels turned up to zero, and all of those are producing similar sounds, even though that all of those individual channels might not be clipping or distorting, when you add all of those channels together, you can actually start clipping the output of your console. Now, I have some pink noise here, and I'm actually gonna turn down my headphone send to you guys with YouTube to see this, but I'm gonna turn this up to zero. And so we can see that I have hit this little orange spot on my meters here. Now, if I then grab my next channel, which has the identical sound. So I've actually duplicated the sound coming into my channel 9, channel 10, channel 11, and channel 12. Now watch my meter. As I turn this up, it just got louder. And again, it got louder again. And again, it got louder again. And at this point, it's pretty loud in your headphones. But what is happening is whenever we have something that's identical, and we bring those two channels together, you are increasing the gain of that output. When we have two identical sources and we join them together, we are getting a plus 3 dB boost out of the output result of that. Now, the same thing happens with speakers. If we have two speakers that are right next to each other, we can actually use both of those speakers at the same time to create more volume. And you can instantly picture the wall of sound way back when they had just tons of speakers together and they were all in unison together, creating a louder output. And so the same fundamentals work when we're joining two channels together is the output of those channels joins. And so this is why this nominal level changes depending on what console you have. So if you have a console that's only 16 channels, you can get away with a little bit hotter of a signal because you only have 16 channels of channels that are joining together for your left-right bus. Now, if you have a console with, say, 48 channels, well, you probably couldn't get away with the gain that I was setting here. So let me turn this down and turn this back up again. And if we had this, and we had 48 channels similar, then this wouldn't be enough what's called headroom for that mixer to join everything together. So maybe you would have to land this more in the negative 24 range rather than the negative 18 range. And so this is why you need to look at your specific mixer and see in the manual if there is a nominal gain setting for that mixer. Now with the Behringer X32, the nominal gain of my channels land anywhere between the negative 22 and the negative 18, depending on who you talk to. Now, the negative 18 mark is one of my favorite spots on the Behringer X32 because that's where the first orange light is. All the rest of them are green. So let's go ahead and actually plug in a microphone and start testing this. So I have this microphone, and this is a Shure SM57, and I have this plugged into my channel 1. So if I start tapping on this, we will see that I have a little bit of green light happening on my meter here. Now this little meter is showing you how much volume this channel is producing. And so if I take this microphone and I turn up this channel, we can't really hear it. I mean, it's too quiet. We can see that it's coming through on the meters, which is great. But what I need to do is I need to turn up the preamp level or the headamp or the gain of this microphone to be able to get it up to that line level for this mixer to be able to actually mix it. And to do that, I'm going to select the channel, and then I'm going to press view in the configuration and preamp section, and then I have this gain knob here in the upper left-hand corner of my mixer. Now, when I press view and selected this channel, we also have a gain knob here. And so I could either adjust the gain knob here on the screen or grab my gain knob here and adjust it here. Now, one other step that we can do is we can actually solo this microphone. And when we solo it, it's doing a number of different things. One, it's taking that channel and isolating it in your headphones that are plugged into your console. The second thing is it turns this big meter right here into a meter for this channel. So at this point, we can see that this is here. Now, if I have this channel turned down, it's not going through to my left-right bus, so it's not going through the PA yet. But because it's soloed up, that meter is showing what's happening on this microphone. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have my musician or my vocalist or whatever sing or play at the loudest level that they would be playing during the next set that's coming up. So say, hey, drummer, I want you to play the last chorus of whatever the loudest song is. Or talk to your bassist and say, hey, I want you to be playing your loudest that you would be during the set. Or go to your guitarist and say, hey, I want you on your loudest guitar patch that you have, and go ahead and play for me. Or that vocalist, have them sing the loudest portion of a song, say the final chorus. And so when you have them play at their loudest, then you can set your preamp level correctly. And so let's go ahead and do this. So I'm going to talk into this microphone, check 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn up the gain of this until I get up to this negative 18 mark with the majority of my signal. Now you'll notice that if I go and shout into this, it's going to go above the negative 18 mark, but it's not going to get into the clipping range. And this is important. Because if we start clipping this channel, check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that distortion that you're hearing is preamp distortion. And so this is distortion that's happening from your microphone being turned up too loud and distorting the preamp. And this is bad because it's giving that distortion sound. Some of you may like this for certain genres, and maybe that's something you're going for. But in this sense, I'm wanting this to sound clear and clean, not distorted. So I don't want to be having this up to the point where it's clipping. Now notice that it's showing a clipping light here. It's showing a clipping light here. And with this channel soloed, it's clipping up here as well. So we want to go ahead and set this at a normal level. So check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so this would be a proper level. And if I go ahead and turn up my output here, unsolo, and then I go ahead and talk into this microphone and I turn this up in the PA, all of a sudden this is going to come through the PA and we can hear it. Now, If you are adjusting a microphone and you're not getting any signal from it, for instance, this microphone, I have this here, and check 1, 2, 3, 4, I have this plugged into my input 2, and I have this turned up and soloed, and I'm not getting anything. In fact, when I turn this up all the way, I still have no sound coming from this microphone. And that's because this is a condenser microphone. And a condenser microphone requires power down the XLR line, or what's called phantom power, or plus 48 volts. And this actually sends a voltage from the console down this XLR line to this microphone to power circuitry inside of the microphone for it to work. And so there's going to be some things that require phantom power. For instance, a condenser microphone or an active direct box is another thing. Those type of things require phantom power. Now, some things that can be destroyed with phantom power would be a ribbon microphone or a dynamic microphone without a transformer inside of it, which most dynamic microphones that we have today have transformers inside of it. And so this would only be an issue if you had a dynamic microphone that was modified to remove the transformer. And so with 48 volts, you can actually heat up the coil of the dynamic microphone and destroy that mic. And ribbon microphones will be destroyed unless they have a transformer. So anytime you're plugging in a ribbon microphone, make sure you do not apply phantom power to it. But condensers require phantom power to work. And so in this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn down my preamp level. I'm then going to select my channel 2 where this microphone is connected, and I'm going to press plus 48. And at this point, I can start turning up the gain on this, and we can see that there is level coming in on this. And so if I go ahead and turn this up loud enough, check 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, we can see that this microphone is now working. And this is because it required that phantom power. Now, there are some gain switches set on microphones. Some microphones, like this one, have what's called a pad switch. And so there is a negative 10 and also a negative 20 pad on this. And so if I set this to negative 20, what that's going to do is that's going to lower the output of this microphone by 20 decibels. And so what you would have to do is you would have to then gain this up 20 dB louder to get to that level. So check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So now we can see that my preamp gain is up at plus 52, which is significantly louder. And so to get to this same gain level, if I had this set to 0, I would have to turn this down by 20 dB. So check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, just like that. Now, getting a solid preamp level or gain level is important for a number of different reasons. One, you don't want to clip your output bus of your main left-right fader. That's why we want to try and hit that nominal gain. Now, I know some of you are thinking, well, I mean, I don't need to have that much output gain. Like, I don't need to be hitting that type of level. I mean, I don't want to clip my output bus of my left-right bus, so maybe I'll just run it lower. Well, the problem with running it lower is that there is a background noise on every piece of audio gear. This is going to be for every type of equipment. Microphones, guitar amps, guitars, basses, keyboards, mixers, speakers, amplifiers, powered speakers, not passive. All of those type of things are going to have some level of self noise within them. And the goal of setting a preamp level that's a nominal gain is to get the most gain before noise, or most signal before noise. So there is this thing called a signal to noise ratio. And the more level that we can run on our channels and have a solid output of our mixer, the less risk we have of amplifying that noise through the PA. So say my levels are only down here, so check 1, 2, and my band is playing at their loudest, and it's all the way down here in the green. The problem is, to get that level up to the volume for the audience to hear it, you would have to turn your speakers or your amplifiers up a lot. And the downside is, then you're going to amplify that noise, because that noise level is down at the 100, negative 100, negative 110 dB level. And so we're wanting to make sure that we don't have that noise coming through the PA. So the best thing to do is to make sure that you're setting a solid level.
Check 1, 2.
And then you turn down your amplifier or up the amplifier to get to the volume that you need that show to be at. I think some of you are going to run into this issue where you start setting your preamp gains correctly, get a solid output coming out of your X32, and then it is too loud in your room. Well, that is because your speakers or your amplifiers are turned up too much. So make sure to set a solid volume on the output of your X32 and then adjust the volume of your amplifiers or your powered speakers to taste to make that volume correct in your room. Now, another reason that we want to have a solid amount of volume on this preamp level is for those of you who are using any sort of monitoring system. Wireless in-ears, wired in-ears, P16 system, anything like that, including wedges, are going to need a solid amount of volume on the channel for your musicians to be able to listen to that at a volume that they need to hear for their in-ears or their wedge that's up on stage for them to be able to play up on stage and listen to the rest of the band. If your input volumes of your microphones are all the way down here, this is not going to be enough volume for being able to send out to all of the monitors in the P16 systems. What's going to happen, especially on the P16, is that your musicians will have to max out the volume of the channel, max out the volume of the headphone amp, and then they still won't be able to hear. And so that's why we want to make sure that when we are setting this preamp level, that we are getting it up to that positive amount of this negative 18 mark, where we're getting that first orange LED. Now, I hope this video was helpful for you today. Remember, preamp is going to change depending on the console that you're using. But for most 32-channel boards, landing in that negative 22 to negative 18 dBFS level, which means that clipping is up at zero and that our nominal gain is at that negative 18 or that first orange LED, is going to give you the best audio quality for your mix. Now, if you do happen to have any questions or there's a video that you're hoping that I would make on the X32 or really any of the production equipment that's out there, please post that in the comment section down below, as I'm always reading through those comments to find videos that can be helpful for you. If you haven't already, make sure to check out my website at drewbrashler.com, where I have a bunch of digital downloads and some courses dedicated to the X32. So you can check that out over at drewbrashler.com. Otherwise, I hope you have a great day.